The Java for loop is one of the most important control statements. You'll be hard-pressed to find any application that doesn't contain a for loop. The Java for loop syntax isn't rocket science either. You're telling Java, I want you to loop over this block, and I want you to do it a set number of times. There are two ways to loop using the for loop, the basic way and the enhanced for loop. In this video, I'm going to show you both, and by the end, you should be a pro with the Java for loop syntax. In this lesson, we're going to learn about looping, specifically for loops. We're going to look at how you can control the direction of the step of the loop. We'll also cover something called for each loops. These are otherwise known as the enhanced for loop. When we're done, you should understand the difference between incrementing and iterating loops. So, let's go take a look at loops. The for loop is a control statement that tells Java to loop over a Java block. Usually, you loop a finite number of times. The Java for loop syntax starts with the keyword for. Each basic for loop has a start, condition, and step. The step initializes any variable you require for the loop. This is only one variable. Other languages do more. Java does one. That's really all you should need unless you're trying to do something really silly clever. Initialization is run only once for the life of the loop, and it happens when you start the loop. The condition tells the loop when to stop. When this condition evaluates to false, the looping stops. The step tells the loop how it should advance for each for loop. Surprisingly, all of these are optional. Here's what it looks like when everything's left out. There's no start, no stop, and no increment, just semicolons. You'd think this wouldn't run, but actually the opposite is true. This runs forever. We've seen how long that is. The important thing to note is each piece of the for loop is optional. There might be a good reason to leave everything optional, but if you need an empty for loop like this, I just make it a while loop with a true condition. It does the same thing. So let's look at what happens in a for loop. The first thing run is the initialization. Here, we're initializing the variable I to 0. Every step we're going to increment I by 1. I'm using the plus unary operator here, but I could have also written I equals I plus 1. The plus operator is just more succinct. The condition is we're not stopping until I is greater than or equal to 10. The condition here says I less than 10. That means if I equals 10, we shouldn't loop. When we first enter the loop, I is 0. The second loop, I is 1, and so on. We continue looping. Every time we loop, the index I is incremented in value by 1. Each loop, we check, is I less than 10? Yes, increment I, and loop again. When I is 10, the condition fails, and the loop stops. Let's take a look at this in code and play with loops a bit. Okay, here I've defined a for loop. It loops from 0 to 99. It loops from 0 to 99 because we have I less than 100. When it hits 100, it'll stop. For every iteration of the loop, we're going to print out the value of I. We run it. And as you can see, it's printed out all the values up to 99, exactly as we expected. Now in this code, we're stepping it one at a time. We have I++ that auto increments it by 1. We could also use the unary operator for addition and add 2 to each one. So in this case, for every step, I is going to step every even value. We run it, and we get all the even values from 0 all the way up to 98. We could even step by 5s if we wanted. And as you can see, it's 15, 20, 25, all the way up to 95. Another cool thing that we can do is we can go backwards. So if we set our initial value to 100, meant I greater than 0, and then subtract 1 from each one. We run this, and it counts from 100 down to 1. Since I cannot equal 0, it has to be greater than 0. Finally, if we go back to our original for loop, where we were printing every value from 0 to 99, we could also say, hey, if I equals 25, then we want to break out. We saw the break statement and the continue statements in the while loop lesson. They work here too in the for loop. So it goes up to 25, and then breaks out. One place you'll see for loops is when you're working with arrays. It's also one place you'll often see looping errors. Let's look at the following example. We have an array. It's got 5 numbers in it. Looping over the array we add one to each element. When we're done, we should have an array that looks like this. Each element is increased in value by one. Look what happens when we include an equal sign. In this case, we're including 5 as an index to update. Our array only has 5 indexes that go from 0 to 4. 5 will cause an error and your program will crash. You're going to see this error often, especially when you're starting out with Java. Let's intentionally cause this error and see what happens. Right. So in this case, I've created an array with 100 elements in it. I'm initializing all of them to be the value 42, and then I'm going to print out the array. We run it. And as you can see, all of the values in our array equal 42. Now what happens if we accidentally say I is less than or equal to 100? In this case, it's including an extra value that's not part of our array. This is a very common error. So when we run it, we get exception and thread, array index out of bounds exception 100. So what we're saying is we've overrun our array and the place that we have an error is 100. This is a very common error, so I wanted to make sure that you saw this. This is a better for loop. It's sometimes called the enhanced for loop. I don't make this stuff up. The way to read this control statement is for each I in array. So when you see the colon, read that as in. The enhanced for loop syntax is the keyword for, the type for each element in your collection, and then the collection. This loop is better because it doesn't care about an index. You don't even need to know how many elements are in the array. You iterate over each item in the array, and the compiler takes care of the range checking for you. Two catches to this loop, though. One, you can't modify each element as you visit it. And two, you don't know the current index. You can certainly put an index in there on your own, but if you really need to, just use the normal for loop. Let's look at the enhanced for loop in code. So here's another way to work with for loops. This is the enhanced for loop. What we're saying here is for every integer in our array, we're going to set it to 42, just like before. Let's run it. And they're all zero. So that's one catch when working with the enhanced for loop. You cannot modify each individual element. If you need to modify each individual element in your array, you're probably better off working with the regular for loop. This does show you, however, how to use the enhanced for loop to iterate over an array. In this case, we could have also done system.out.println I. And what this will do is visit each element in our array. And it prints out zeros again. So we've been playing with numbers, but you can also iterate over other types. Here's an example of iterating over a character array. The output would be ASDF. I'll leave this as an exercise for you to type this loop in. If you have questions, leave it in the comments and I'll gladly help you out.
I'd say that 90% of the time, I use the enhanced for each loop and iterate over the arrays. The Java for loop syntax is much simpler with the enhanced for loops and it leads to safer code. That means it's less likely to break with weird errors. Both loops are almost always the same speed. Normal for loops can be slightly faster if the array is an array of integers, but in all other array types, it makes no difference. You really shouldn't worry about it. It's a judgment call over which one you use, but if you can iterate using a for each instead of incrementing using a normal loop, go for the iterations. All right, as always, if you have any questions, leave them in the comments below. And with that, I'll see you in the next lesson.
Hey, thanks for watching the video. There's a quick quiz for this on dgu.com if you'd like to gauge how much you learned. If you like the videos you're seeing, please let me know by liking the video and hitting the subscribe button for the DGU channel on YouTube. I'd really appreciate that. If you have concerns or questions, please leave them in the comments below or on dgu.com. There's a poll on the front page of dgu.com, so you can also let me know what topic gets covered next. Thanks for watching and see you in the next video.